It was a very complicated piece. I had, before I'd sold the show, I had outlined the whole season. Not beat by beat, but I had these broad stroke outlines because I wanted to know in my own head that I could pull it off and that I thought this could work before I even sold it to anyone. So I had kind of sketched it out and had sort of the season sketched out. And then it was originally at FX instead of Hulu, and they made me do a 10-page document on what the season would be. So there was so much work that had gone into it that by the time I started episode 2, I had a strong sense of how it would work. Now, that doesn't mean I didn't know it would work, because it's a complicated narrative device of having intertwining stories like this. You know, you could say it's complicated, although, you know, in any TV show there's intertwining stories, but normally they're all connected in some way. They're part of the same family or the same office, right? Where this is these different stories. But then to make things even harder, they took place in 3 different time periods. So now why did I do that? Well, the investigations 2002 to 2007, the Purdue storyline, I had to do the origin story of the launch of OxyContin. That's 1996. I have to show the victims. That's 1996. The DEA investigations 2000, right? So if I just did it linear, then that means the first 6 episodes would just be Purdue Pharma and the victims. Then episode 5, the DEA agent comes in. Then episode seven, the prosecutors come in. That would have been a very bad television show. It wouldn't have worked. It literally wouldn't have worked. I mean, part of part of what makes the show so intense is that the investigations are happening simultaneously as they're committing the crimes and as we're watching the victims. So it really was the only way that I believed the story could work, and I thought it could be pretty cool. And I'll be honest with you, I've in the last 2 days it's aired in the US, and I've had several writers reach out to me, friends and colleagues that have seen it, and they're all like, how the fuck did you do that at the time? It's unbelievable. You know, it's like the thing that writers are kind of most impressed with, because there's some craftsmanship there, you know? Like, it was not easy to do. So that's been lovely.
I imagine lots of different colored note cards and a very big board.
I wish it would have been, but there was a thing called a worldwide pandemic. So we had no writer's room, so we had to do it virtually.
Oh my God.
So there was no, we had bought all the different cards, we bought all the boards. And then week 2 of the room, bam, shut down. So it was all virtual, and it was really interesting doing the room virtually. There was no board, which is fine by me because I was a screenwriter for a decade before I ever started writing television. So it's not like I need the board or I can't do this, you know. But there was no board, and then I would get confused if I wasn't taking the notes. So I ended up being the showrunner and the writer's assistant because I was taking all the notes, and it was very confusing to people. They're like, why are you taking the notes? And I'm like, this isn't because I'm trying to be humble. I'm just doing it because it's just to keep all this straight in my head because it's very confusing. And everyone in the room said, yeah, we know you're not trying to be humble. That we get. But it was just a, you know, you just go with what you got. So.
Mm-hmm.